If anyone has seen the movie October Sky, you may be familiar with this scene. You're the one to blame. Oh, well, goodbye. Although I'll cry. Did NASA really use something like this to protect the engineers and photographers from the violent output of the rocket? Did they always have to push a big red button to launch the rocket? Your questions answered on the next Vintage Retrospect. Seventy-five years ago saw the German V2 rocket shake things up in America when it comes to aerospace innovation. Yes, the V2 had various color schemes, and this yellow and black version was a crazy reality. I personally love this scheme myself. In 1950, the first Cape Canaveral launch ever occurred. The V2 became paired with a solid rocket booster second stage. This setup became the Bumper 8 rocket. This second stage used a whack corporal sounding rocket mounted on top of a V2. But what's this have to do with blockhouses? Recently, students from the University of Central Florida discovered the remains of the Launch Complex 3 blockhouse early this spring. A 20-foot by 20-foot section of the foundation was found, as well as some fragments of electronics and other items. But let's go back in time to 1950 and learn more about this historic relic. Blockhouses were the main defense from human interface to rocket operations. The need for the blockhouse was identified just around the V2 days of rocketry. How were the early blockhouses made? To start the construction process, a temporary wooden building was erected on a 20-foot by 20-foot cement slab. Positioned approximately 500 feet away from the launch pad, its purpose was to accommodate the firing crew and support personnel. The majority of its structure consisted of wood, while the exterior was lined with a grayish silver felt overlay designed to reflect sunlight, providing a unique way to cool the building. Inside the building, a mirror-like window allowed occupants to view the launch while remaining at a lower level. For added protection, the outside walls were partially shielded by a sand embankment fortified with around 5,000 sandbags. Eyewitnesses of the bumper launches unanimously agree that this building would not have provided sufficient protection had one of the rockets exploded nearby. This is evidenced by the fact that several individuals took shelter in foxhole-type trenches nearby, while other photographers and other personnel stationed themselves outside the surface level outside the blockhouse. The blockhouse adequately shielded personnel and equipment from bad weather conditions as needed. After about 1 year following the bumper launches, this temporary blockhouse was dismantled. The concrete slab remained visible in aerial photographs of Cape Canaveral for many years until vegetation overtook the area. But what about all the missile row pads? In my recent released episode about missile row, I briefly touched on blockhouses for the missile row pads. These, of course, were constructed with permanency in mind. This means higher quality materials and concrete construction. Let's just use Launch Complex 14, for example. These things were not cheap either. The total cost of the blockhouse for Pad 14 was $821,989. Another great example of the vintage blockhouses was the one located by Pad 26. This blockhouse supported the Juno 2, Jupiter C, and Redstone rockets from 1958 through 1964. And yes, I know you have been dying for me to answer this question. Was there really a red button the launch director had to push to launch the vehicle? Yes, indeed. This button was, of course, under lock and key, placed on a launch console podium. The key had to be turned, then the button can be pressed when the countdown reached zero. This button simply closed an electrical current gap, which sent a signal to the firing block out at the launch pad. The privileged person to turn the key and press the button was called the candle lighter. And this name became the idea behind Alan Shepard's famous "Let's light this candle, go fever" phrase to launch the Mercury Redstone. They also had computers in the blockhouse. Not those kind. These used tape data and weighed as much as some of today's automobiles. If you found this content informative, please support me in hitting the like and subscribing so that the video stays high in the playlist of people who will discover with this video that the push button launches were just like the movie October Sky in the 1950s. I am your host, Chad. and I will see you out on the launch pad.